बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम आरिफ एंड आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू लेक्चर नंबर 26 ऑन द सब्जेक्ट ऑफ कंप्यूटर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एंड असेंबली लैंग्वेज प्रोग्रामिंग। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज द फर्स्ट सेशन ऑफ द सेकेंड हाफ और पोस्ट मिड पार्ट ऑफ आर कोर्स। इन द फर्स्ट हाफ ऑफ द कोर्स वी स्टार्टेड विद द यूनिवर्सल नैंड गेट, designed and wrote the HDL of a full blown 16-bit von Neumann computer having a CPU consisting of an ALU, three registers and a control unit, two separate memory modules serving as instruction memory and data memory, a screen and a keyboard interface with the computer using memory mapped IO technique. Dear students, we also designed the machine as well as the assembly language for this computer called the HAC computer, and finally designed an assembler program for it as well. So this is the summary of the pre-mid part, and now let us start with the post-mid part, in which we will learn the assembly of the x86 64-bit architecture. But as usual, instead of straight away jumping on understanding and writing x86 assembly, I will take 2 to 3 sessions to set the stage right. Dear students, being the first course on the subject, we will not be doing scuba diving on the architectural concepts of the latest processors like the isolated IO techniques of interfacing IO devices with the computer system, data transfer techniques like program controlled IO, interrupt initiated IO and direct memory access, pipelined superscalar, multi-core and multiprocessor architectures, techniques like out of order execution, register renaming, branch prediction, hyperthreading and speculative instruction execution. Moreover, improving processor performance using direct map, associative map and set associative caches. I will not be going into the details of these concepts. However, I will give you a bird's eye view of all these concepts, and the scuba diving will be done in the computer architecture course that is normally taught in the last year of BS computer science program. So anyways, dear students, let us start with the history, which I personally never liked in my school days. But now I say, teaching a new concept starts from the history of that concept, or from the time the concept was coined. So let us start from the evolution of Intel microprocessors. Well, this slide shows the agenda. Most of you might be knowing that Intel Corporation is a multinational American technology company headquartered in Santa Clara, California in Silicon Valley. Intel stands for Integrated Electronics, and it is the world's largest semiconductor chip manufacturer and inventor of the famous x86 series of microprocessors, which are supplied to computer system manufacturers like Alpha, Lenovo, HP and Dell. Today I will say a few words on some of the important Intel microprocessor architectures, starting from 4004, one of the first microprocessors ever produced by Intel in 1971, and moving progressively to the Intel Core architecture, launched in 2006, 14 years ago. And finally, we will talk about the Intel processor generations, which mainly come after the release of Core I series, starting from the Intel first generation Nehalem micro architecture launched in 2008, and moving progressively to the Intel 10th generation Comet Lake microarchitecture, which was launched in 2019. Dear students, these generation code names over here like Sandy Bridge, Ivy Bridge, Sky Lake, and so on, are the names of towns, rivers, or mountains near the location of Intel facility responsible for the specific IC chip. Okay, I think this is really important history, and we need to talk it in a bit of detail today. So let us move ahead. Well, Intel 4004 launched in 1971 was a 4-bit microprocessor. By 4-bit, I mean its word size or register size is of 4 bits. It was having a 12-bit address bus that could address a memory of 4 KB. The chip was composed of roughly 2300 transistors and could operate on a frequency or clock speed of 400 to 800 kilohertz. And as you can see in the figure, the 4004 chip was available in a 16-pin dual inline package. 4004 processor used to take 8 clock cycles to fetch, decode, and execute one instruction. So if the chip is working at let's say 400 kilohertz, it could roughly execute 50,000 instructions in 1 second. At that time, this processor was used in a 4-bit BCD oriented BusyCom calculator. My dear students, you don't really have to memorize all the characteristics of all the processors we are going to discuss today. The objective of today's session is to make you realize how the things started 50 years back, how the microprocessor technology progressed over time, and where we are standing now in the year 2020. Okay. So, well, this slide shows the characteristics of the next important Intel microprocessor, 8008, launched in 1972, which was a 8-bit processor having an address bus of 14 bits. A point I want to highlight is it was 8008 in which the concept of interrupts was introduced. And you all know that an interrupt is an event generated to get the attention of the CPU. It is basically a request to the processor to interrupt the currently executing code and execute some other code called the interrupt service routine. And of course, it was this capability of the hardware that later led to the development of multitasking operating systems. Well, Intel 8080 launched in 1974 was a 8-bit microprocessor with a 16-bit address bus. The chip was composed of 4500 transistors and could operate on a frequency or clock speed of 2 MHz. And as you can see in the figure, 8080 processor was available in a 40-pin DIP package. Well, in 1978, Intel launched the 8086 microprocessor, this one, which left a mark in the history and is still referred to as the x86 architecture. My dear students, 8086 was a 16-bit processor with an addressable memory of 1 MB byte, which was 16 times greater than what 8080 could support. That is 64 KB. To port all assembly programs running on 8080 to run on 8086 as well, Intel introduced the concept of segmented memory model. And we will talk about this model in detail in some future session. Well, the shown 8086 chip available in 40-pin DIP package was composed of around 29,000 transistors and could operate on a frequency or clock speed ranging from 5 to 10 MHz. Well, in the late 70s, the semiconductor technology was not to the point where Intel could put floating point instructions directly on the 8086 chip. So they designed a separate floating point unit chip named 8087, having 8 80-bit data registers organized as a stack, and Intel named these registers as ST0, ST1, ST2 and so on to ST7. Dear students, I will of course talk a bit about the architecture of 8086 processor in some future session, inshallah. And these days, this 8086 microprocessor is still used in some low-cost microcontrollers. Well, based on the 8086 architecture, in 1982, Intel launched 80286 microprocessor, which was a 16-bit processor with 24-bit address bus. With this processor, the transistor count raised from 29K to 134K, and the clock speed was also raised to 20 megahertz. And this reminds me of Gordon Moore, the co-founder of Intel, who gave an observation that number of transistors on a microchip doubles every 2 years. And this is quite true. Well, Intel introduced a new math coprocessor, 8287, to work with 8286 processor. And in Intel 8286, the concept of protected memory was also introduced. In real mode, only 1 MB of memory is accessible, while protected mode enables this 24-bit addressing as well. 8286 also introduced the Integrated Drive Electronics, IDE, bus architecture, which is shown over here. And that is used to connect the hard drive or CD drive with the computer. You can see the back of the IDE hard drive shown over here. And this is the cable and the 40-pin IDE connector. Finally, dear students, 8286 also introduced the concept of data transfer between memory and I/O devices using something that is called a DMA controller. And DMA stands for direct memory access. I think in the pre-mid part, we talked about the program controlled I/O, in which the hack processor that we designed used to keep scanning the keyboard, rather the memory map of the keyboard, where the data is whether the data is ready or not. And of course, during that time, the processor can do nothing other than just looping inside that code and checking that the data is available for the keyboard or not. So that was the program controlled I/O. The other technique is interrupt driven I/O, in which the processor do not scan for the device to be ready, rather is informed about the data availability using an interrupt. However, the fast processor is of course involved during the data transfer at the speed of the slow I/O device. And this limitation is also overcome in 8286, which used this DMA controller chip. Well, dear students, I recommend that the students who are interested, they should study at their own the three DMA controller data transfer modes, like the burst mode, the cycle stealing mode, and the transparent mode. These are the techniques that, of course, will be taught to you in the computer architecture course in the 7th year of the BS Computer Science program. Well, now comes 1985, when Intel introduced the 8386 processor with the 32-bit data bus and 32-bit address bus, and thus capable of addressing 4 GB bytes of mean memory. The transistor count raised to 275K and the clock frequency to about 33 MHz. Intel designed a better floating point unit, 80387, also known as I387, for use in 8386 systems. Moreover, 8386 also introduced the concept of memory paging and virtual memory, which you will study in depth in your operating system course. Well, in 1989, Intel introduced 8486 or I486 with 8 KB on-chip cache, an internal enhanced floating point coprocessor, and a 5-stage instruction pipeline. It is generally accepted that the same clock speed, 8486, showed 50% improved performance over the 8386 processor. And as far as this instruction pipelining is concerned, this is a technique for implementing instruction level parallelism within a single processor. Well, I don't promise, but I will try to make a separate video on pipelined processors in this course as well, inshallah. Well, in 1993, Intel launched the P5 microarchitecture, also referred to as the 80586 or the I586. Pentium 1 and Pentium 2 were the Intel brands based on this P5 architecture. One of the techniques used in P5 architecture to achieve performance gain was a wider data bus and 64-bit general purpose registers. With 64-bit address bus as well, the addressable memory range also increased up to 16 XB. The transistor count also went up to 3.2 million and the clock frequency up to 300 MHz. Well, instead of a single on-chip cache to store recently used data and instructions, 8586 used two separate on-chip caches, one for data and one for instruction. Moreover, instead of using direct map cache, 8586 used two-way set associative cache, having fewer address conflicts and therefore having a lower miss rate. I hope you will study different cache models in your computer architecture course as well. Well, dear students, even a pipelined processor cannot execute more than one instruction per cycle. 8586 was the Intel's first superscalar architecture or superscalar design with two parallel 5-stage pipelines and therefore capable of executing two instructions per clock cycle, ideally speaking. And finally, later versions of P5 architecture also introduced multimedia extension instructions to support SIMD or single instruction multiple data stream operations. Well, in 1997, Intel launched the P6 microarchitecture, also referred to as 8586 or 80. It was an extension of 8586. It was frequently referred to as 8686 or I686 architecture. In I686, the clock rate went up to 3.8 GHz to achieve more and more performance gain. And of course, the data in the address bus size was 64-bit. The on-chip data and instruction cache sizes also went up to about 32 KB. And instead of two parallel 5-stage pipeline, I686 was also a superscalar design but with three parallel 12-stage pipeline, and therefore capable of executing 3 instructions in each clock cycle. I686 also support out of order execution, register renaming, improved branch prediction, and speculative instruction execution. And I hope you will study these concepts as well in detail in your computer architecture course. Please don't worry about that. You just need to have a bit of idea about these terms and concepts. And you will of course do scuba diving about these concepts in that course. Well, dear students, Pentium 3 was the Intel brand based on P6 architecture, which introduced a new SIMD technology called Streaming SIMD Extension, or SSE in short. And of course, we will inshallah talk about this SSE and MMX instruction at the end of this part of our course. Well, Pentium 4 raised the clock frequency to 3.8 GHz and also gave the support of hyper-threading technology as well. And the hyper-threading is Intel-specific hardware that allows two threads to be executed simultaneously on one physical processor. Well, dear students, the 64-bit Intel Pentium 6 series went up to a maximum clock rate support of 3.8 GHz, increasing the performance of microprocessors by increasing the clock speed suffered from two limitations. The first is more consumption of power, and the second is more dissipation of heat. Later, thinking that two heads are better than one, Intel designer shifted their concentration on multi-core technologies. So in 2006, Intel launched its core microarchitecture called Intel Core. As it is apparent from this diagram as well, multi-core means multiple processing cores on the same chip or die. The processors of a core microarchitecture can be categorized by the number of cores. For example, over here we have 1, 2, 3, 4 cores. The number and the size of caches. For example, over here we have separate instruction and data cache at level 1. We have these caches per core. Then we have L2 cache for instruction as well as for data per core. Then we have L3 cache, which is shared among all these cores. And then we of course have the main memory, which is also shared among all these cores. And of course, the size and the number of sockets also categorize the core microarchitecture. So there are three important things whenever we talk about the core microarchitecture. The first is the number of cores, the second is the number of caches and the sizes, and the third is the sockets. You can see on this slide, this is a hypothetical core, multi-core processor having this hypothetical architecture. And of course, the challenges of such multi-core architectures are the cache coherence, memory coherence, and communication among different cores. And last but not the least, programmers also need to learn about writing programs that can execute on multiple cores. Well, Core Solo and Core Duo are the two Intel brands based on Intel Core microarchitecture, which refers to Intel's 32-bit mobile dual-core x86 CPUs. In Core Solo, actually, Intel simply disabled the second core, while in Core Duo, both cores are enabled. Then Core to Solo, Core to Duo, Core to Quad, and Core to Extreme, they are of 64-bit. This Core to Quad consists of Core to Duo chips, two Core to Duo chips, thus forming a quad core processor. This Core to Extreme are the versions of Core to Duo and Core to Quad processors with the higher frequencies. Well, in 2008, Intel launched the Nehalem microarchitecture and also introduced a new naming scheme for its core processors. And there are, at that time, three variants: Core i3, Core i5, and Core i7. And of course, the names have nothing to do with the number of cores they have. Core i3 comes with a slow clock speed without turbo boost. Normally have two cores with four threads and hyper-threading enabled. Core i5 comes with turbo boost, allowing faster speed when the processor is under high demand. Normally have four cores, four threads with hyper-threading disabled. Core i7 is for power users with more cache, more clock speed and more cores. And Core i7 normally have 8 to 16 threads with hyper-threading enabled. The Intel first generation processor comes in Core i3, Core i5 and Core i7. And then the second generation of Intel processor, this Sandy Bridge, was launched in 2011. And along with other features, introduced, excuse me for my bad throat. So this Sandy Bridge architecture was launched in 2011, and along with the other new features, also introduced a new SIMD technology called the Advanced Vector Extension (AVX). And in 2012, Intel launched the Ivy Bridge, the third generation processor. These Ivy Bridge processors are faster than Sandy Bridge and consumes 50% less energy and give 25% improved performance than the Sandy Bridge. The limitation was that they emit more heat as compared to Sandy Bridge processors. In 2013, Intel launched Haswell, the fourth generation processor. It included AVX version 2, Advanced Vector Extension version 2, using 256-bit registers. And one of the advantages of Haswell is that it can be used in ultra-portable devices due to its low power consumption. In 2014, Intel launched a Broadwell microarchitecture, the fifth generation processor, which features faster wake-up time, improved graphic performance, and with two-channel DDR3 RAM. In 2015, Intel launched Skylake, the sixth generation processor. In 2016, Intel launched Kaby Lake, the seventh generation processor. In 2017, Intel launched a refresh of Kaby Lake as their new 8th generation release. The details are same, however, some of the 8th generation chipsets have support for the DDR4 RAM as well. Well, in late 2017, Intel launched Coffee Lake, the 9th generation processor. With this architecture, Intel Core i9 processors were also introduced, having 8 cores per CPU and up to 16 MB of L3 cache. Since the heat produced by these processor cores was enormous, Intel attached the integrated heat spreader IHS to this CPU die instead of the thermal paste which was used in the earlier processors. Well, in 2018, Intel introduced Cannon Lake, the 10th generation architecture. With other new features, this is the first CPU architecture that comes with integrated support for Wi-Fi 6 and Thunderbolt 3. Well, dear students, this slide shows the naming convention of latest Intel processors. The naming scheme starts with the processor brand, which can be Intel Core or maybe Intel Pentium, Intel Celeron. The Intel Core processor series also include a brand modifier as shown over here, which can be i3, i5, i7 and i9. Intel Pentium and Intel Celeron processors, of course, do not use this naming convention. Anyway, after the brand modifier comes the four-digit generation indicator. The first two digits typically represent the generation from generation 10 onward. And of course, for the previous generation, only one digit represents the generation. The remaining digits are called SKU digits, and within a product line, higher digits, higher number digits generally have more features. And finally, we have the product line suffix. U means ultra low power. This indicates a processor that has been designed for a power efficient laptop, for example. You can have other characters over here. For example, X or XE indicates an extreme edition processor for desktops designed for maximum performance. And of course, my dear students, you can dig out more at your own time as far as the naming convention of Intel microprocessors are concerned. Okay, dear students, that is all for today's session. I have tried my best to give you an overview of different Intel microprocessors and their characteristics as they evolve over the time. I hope today's session was informative for you all. If you have liked it, please subscribe my YouTube channel and share it with your friends. I wish you all the best. Happy learning and Allah Hafiz.